pleasure to introduce Dr. Sven Wortmann. Sven is a researcher at the Institute of Indology and Tamil Studies at University of Cologne. He also specializes in psychology at the University of Hagen. He was also a research associate at the Ruhr University of Religious Studies. His publications include Strategies of the Vedic Brahmanic Religion for Coping with Religious Plurality, Periyar E.V. Ramaswamy, A Short Biography, among others. He is very passionate in the areas of Tamil teaching and interreligious perceptions. Sven has developed deep ties with South India and Tamil land.
Yeah, I'm quite excited. This is probably my first humanistic sermon, so to say. So, brothers and sisters in Homo sapiens, dear American friends, my dear two German friends, Tamil Nanbargale Vanakkam. In my short talk, I would like to convince you to grant basic human rights to gibbons, and I will also show you why it is appropriate for Western humanists to be more vegetarian, whereas it's appropriate for Indian humanists not to be 100% vegetarian. Seems a bit disconnected, but I'll try my best to make sense of it. In traditional forms of humanism, which assigns a predominant interest to the affairs of men as compared with the supernatural or the abstract, that's a quote from the Encyclopedia Britannica, humans are the worldview's center and reference point. This implies protection from a twofold discrimination. Firstly, protection from alleged supernatural agents, which means secularism. Secondly, protection from discrimination by other humans, which means universal human rights, which have widely been accepted since the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in 1948 by the UN. So, nowadays, humans grant each other universal human rights on the basis of belonging to the species Homo sapiens. Historically, this is a climax in the extension of social behavior from close relatives to larger groups, like from family, tribe, caste, ethnic group, religious group, nation, and now species of all humans. Such a humanism or hominism is therefore a form of a speciesism. And I think this is not surprising. So such a humanism or hominism is therefore a form of speciesism. And I think this is not surprising given the fact that the basic principle of life is selfishness, or to put it less selfish, self-preservation. In other words, how could a worldview created by and for humans not be human-focused? However, in modern humanism or evolutionary humanism, a term created by the first director of UNESCO, Julian Huxley, in 64, we want to continuously update our knowledge and take into account the latest scientific insights. The natural sciences teach us that humans are part of the animal realm, and that we literally share the same ancestors with all other living beings. We are, for example, genetically approximately 98% identical with our closest extant relatives, the chimpanzees. There is no fundamental difference between humans and other animals, let alone a special mental entity like the soul. Traditionally exclusive human traits like usage of tools, social behavior, and complex communication have been found to be abundant in the animal realm. And even concerning our higher cognitive faculties, for example, language, consciousness, imagination, foresight, scientists have been bridging the gap between humans and other animals. Our faculties, in that extent, only seem to be unique to us in a matter of degree, not of category. So if we assume a quality of belonging to humanity, a humanness, or so to say, a VIP ticket, it must have, like all other traits, evolved gradually. There was never one defining moment when our ancestors suddenly became human. In consequence, some people propose we should also gradually expand our social behavior to other sentient animals. And I see two major motivations which can serve for this purpose: reciprocal altruism and pure empathy. Reciprocal altruism is a form of teamwork which, in our everyday life experience, mainly works with domesticated animals like dogs or horses. In a wider sense, it can be viewed as social behavior towards animals without expecting a direct reward, but an indirect ecological reward, the preservation of the ecosystem, which we are dependent on. In this wider sense, I would like to call it ecological altruism. Pure empathy, however, is mostly based on the impression of similarity. The more similar animals are to us, the more empathy we tend to develop, which, by the way, teaches us that even empathy has an element of selfishness. Given the similarities between humans and other complexly developed mammals, humanists have already updated their ethical and legal outlook. One example is the Great Ape Project, launched in 1993. It tries to implement basic rights, the right to live, the protection of individual liberty, and the prohibition of torture for the so-called great apes. So these are not the board members of the Giordano Bruno Stiftung, but these are actually the beneficiaries. So the so-called great apes, the gorilla, orang-utan, bonobo, and chimpanzee. In most cases, that means changing the legal status of great apes from objects to subjects. To my knowledge, at the moment, at least animal testing on great apes is currently prohibited by law in the Netherlands, New Zealand, United Kingdom, Sweden, Germany, and Austria. Let me now elaborate on the problem of drawing the line and deciding which animals should enjoy which amount of basic rights. That's a big question. And this problem is already manifest in the Great Ape Project itself, because the project only includes the family of the great apes, chimpanzees, bonobos, gorillas, and orang-utans, but excludes the other so-called lesser apes, the gibbons. Gibbons live in the rainforest in Southeast Asia. They are up to 90 centimeters high and weigh about 12 kilograms. And may I ask, who already knew this species of gibbons? Please raise your hands. Oh, that's great. Okay. Oh, not bad. So, gibbons are also part of the superfamily of apes, or Hominoidea. There are the superfamily of apes, and here are the gibbons. In German and in Tamil, we have a better name for apes. We call it Menschenaffe, Tamil Manindagurangu. Both literally means human monkey. So they're all tailless and biped, upright moving or brachiating, as opposed to the quadruped monkeys with tails. The reason for leaving out gibbons in this project are surprisingly weak. Among apes, gibbons are the least related to humans. They are smaller, they are less known, and there's less research on them compared to other apes. Less research, however, does not mean insufficient research. The findings suggest that in terms of emotion, intelligence, and consciousness, gibbons are quite similar to the other non-human apes. There are even some characteristics in which gibbons are more human-like than other apes. They are the most upright moving, the most orally communicating, and the most monogamous among the non-human apes. So basically, their relationships are quite human. They live in couples which sometimes cheat on each other secretly. So, a great comparative work on all apes, including humans and gibbons, is Darwin's Traum, Die Entstehung des menschlichen Bewusstseins. That means Darwin's Dream, The Emergence of Human Consciousness, by Adolf Heschel, 2009. The author argues that when the ancestors of the apes split from monkeys by developing the upright gait, walking and brachiation, their whole body, especially hands and feet, became fully visible and came under conscious control. The option of consciously using hand and feet for climbing, brachiation, and manipulating objects sharpened the visual and cognitive subject-object distinction. Thereby, apes developed a unique degree of consciousness, which was the foundation for all other human-like achievements. So on the basis of these considerations, I would argue that in terms of biological classification, we should not draw the line within the level of family, but rather between family and order, thereby also including gibbons for granting basic rights, because they share more with the other apes than with monkeys. Among the above-mentioned countries where animal testing on great apes is prohibited, Austria is the only country to protect gibbons as well. But on the other hand, one could argue that in tests on consciousness, IQ, and the usage of tools, gibbons tend to score lower or less consistent than other apes and therefore do not deserve the above-mentioned basic rights. The discussion about basic rights for apes, and of course other animals, is a difficult but I think inevitable consequence of humanism acknowledging science. Whereas this topic has practical everyday relevance for non-human apes, it is rather a topic of empathy or ecological altruism for us. Therefore, I shall now touch upon the more self-referential topic of humanism and the consumption of animal products, especially meat. In the Western world, between 5 and 10% of the population has one form of vegetarian diet. So we see here UK, Germany, Canada, 9%, USA, 5 to 8%, and then Ireland, France, Australia, 5%. The reasons for a vegetarian diet are mostly concerns for animal welfare, one's own health, and ecological concerns. And these ecological concerns in vegetarianism have become a global relevance. In general, the meat industry demands much more energy and water and other resources, such as grain, and produces much more emission of greenhouse gases than agriculture. The percentage of vegetarians in the West is higher among young adults, which correlates highly with a secular worldview among young adults. It is therefore not unreasonable to assume that in the Western world, humanism correlates with vegetarianism, or at least with a conscious and reduced meat consumption, which we call flexitarianism. May I ask, who is vegetarian in this room? All right. Okay, interesting. So in India, we have quite a different situation. According to the latest research by the Register General of India in 2014, 38% of the population are vegetarians, but there's a huge difference between the northern states, like for example Rajasthan, Punjab, and Madhya Pradesh, with an extremely high percentage of vegetarians, and the southern states. The northern states I mentioned are here Rajasthan, Punjab, and Madhya Pradesh here. And the Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh are here. So they have a quite low percentage of vegetarians. We have to take into account that food habits in India are strongly based on religion and caste affiliation, much less on individual choice. Concerning the religious arguments for the treatment of animals, we have to differentiate between killing and eating animals. In Jainism and Buddhism, for example, killing animals is morally condemnable not only because of empathy, but also because of fear of karmic punishment. In Hinduism, eating animals primarily affects the ritual purity of people. For Hindus, killing cows and eating beef is generally a taboo. Otherwise, Hindu castes differ in their degree of vegetarianism. Within the Brahmin Hindu framework, the hierarchy of castes is determined, among other factors, by their respective ritual purity, which involves food habits. the low percentage of vegetarians in the southern states correlates with the prevalence of lower castes compared to the north. And historically, some castes have raised their status by becoming more vegetarian. For humanists, of course, almost all traditional reasons for vegetarianism in India, karma, purity, caste, except empathy, are invalid. By practicing vegetarianism, they could silently look like if they were confirming religious frameworks. That is why being non-vegetarian, or at least openly eating some beef and pork in India, can be a strong humanist statement against religion, against notions of purity and impurity, and against the caste system. This comparison between Western and Indian vegetarianism illustrates how the significance and effects of a lifestyle can differ depending on the context. In conclusion, the subjects I touched on illustrate that humanism has to be a learning system because it faces new challenges in different environments. The price for our freedom is thinking, negotiating, and sometimes bearing imperfection and dilemmas. And that's the tea. Amen.